So welcome to day three of this training course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. So today our topic of discussion is searching. So in the first day, I have discussed about some notions about the artificial intelligence, the history of AI, and followed by some mathematical discussion on the linear algebra, and at the same time, some discussion on the probability theory. Yesterday, I have discussed about the introduction to a machine learning technology, and in regard to that, I've talked about the regression algorithm and the classifier algorithm. Now, today, I'll be discussing about the searching, and it is thought that searching is one of the important attributes of any AI system. In fact, over a long time, artificial intelligence or AI is thought as a subject which deals with searching only. However, over the years, the notion has been changed. But still, if you ask any traditional researcher who are doing their research in the area of AI over 30 years or 40 years, then perhaps you will say that this AI is all about searching. Although the notion has been changed dramatically today, apart from searching, we have certain other attributes that can be associated with AI system. Anyway, so first of all, we have to understand what is meant by searching. And in this particular lecture, I'll be discussing about the different types of searching one by one, and the associated advantages and disadvantages for each of them. The first question is that, what is searching? Let me pose the question first. Or, why do we search at all? That you have to understand at the very beginning. That what is searching? Searching means we are trying to find a solution. In one word, I can explain the notion of searching in that way. So given a problem, we would like to find a solution of the problem. And that solution can be figured out by means of searching. But is it the case that all the problems can be solved by means of searching only? Or in other words, is searching the only way through which we can find a solution? So let me clarify this point at the very beginning. Suppose you are given a problem on mathematics. For example, you are asked to find out the integration of a function. Some function fx is given to you, y is equal to fx. And you have to find out the integration of that. So you know how to find it out. There are different laws of integration. It may be definite integral or it may be indefinite integral. So you know what are the steps to follow. And accordingly, you can find out the solution. So we have discussed about the probability theory in the first day. And particularly, I have talked about an example where there are two boxes. One red box, another blue box. And there are a few apples and few oranges in each of the box. And you have to find out whether or what is the probability that if you pick a fruit from any of the box, what is the probability that that particular fruit is an apple or orange? Or the question may be like that. Suppose you pick a fruit and it is found to be apple or orange, then what is the probability that it is taken from the box number one or box number two or red box or blue box? So in that case, you have to follow some well-known theorem. In particular, we have talked about the Bayes theorem, and you can use that particular theorem to solve that problem. So the solution to these type of problems is well-known to you. You know there are certain theorems, there are certain formula, and you have to apply those formula to reach a solution. So for every mathematical problem, if I consider with which you normally deal, so they can be solved if you follow a particular way of solution. But however, we cannot say that this is a problem of searching. If you are asked to find out the derivative of a complicated function, or if you are asked to find out the Fourier transform of a time domain signal, you know how to solve it. Suppose a signal is given in the time domain. Now you are asked to find out the frequency component of that signal. Now you can do it very easily. There are certain transformation theory, and you can take the help of those transformation formula, and you can apply this one, and accordingly you'll be getting the result. So there is no ambiguity. Then what makes this searching problem different from the other way of problem solution? The thing is that in case of searching, we do have a number of potential solutions, and we have to pick one solution or more than one solution depending upon the requirement of the problem under consideration. For example, I can give you the instance whenever, suppose some crime has occurred, some murder has occurred, and a policeman has come to identify who is the murderer. A typical criminal problem. So under this condition, the policeman has to identify who are the persons who might be or who might have some chance to kill that particular victim. So accordingly, he has to identify a set of population, suppose 10 people, 20 people, 50 people, depending upon the connection and all. And based on that, the policeman or the police department has to identify the motive, the tool used to commit the murder, the weapon, the time of the murder, the place of the murder, and accordingly, out of these 20 people, then by the process of elimination, one or more people are eliminated from the process of investigation, and ultimately, the person can be accused. The murderer can be identified. So initially, all the 20 people or all the 40 people under the investigation, they can be thought as a potential murderer initially. And then someone has some guidance, and based on the guidance, the actual solution, that means the real murderer, is identified. So this is a problem of searching. So initially all of them are thought to be, or they are considered to be murderer initially, as initial guess. You can also find this kind of scenario in any of the detective story. So the basic notion of searching is that given a problem, and you have to solve it by means of some technique, by means of some algorithm. And obviously, we'll be discussing about the different types of algorithms. So as I was mentioning, for long, it was thought that AI can solve any type of problems through searching. By using searching, AI can solve any type of problem. It was thought for long. Now, if all the problems in the world can be solved by AI, artificial intelligence, that means what? All the problem input can be modeled synonymously to the searching algorithm. For example, if I consider the searching phenomena as a black box, Suppose this is a searching algorithm. I don't know what is there inside the algorithm or inside this black box. But suppose it's an efficient algorithm which can solve any types of problems in the world. Now for any algorithm, as you know, a set of input or a single input is given, and at the output you can have either one output or a set of outputs depending upon the problem statement. So what is the input over here? The problem variable, or rather problem only. You have to define the problem, and at the output you need to provide a solution. This is the basic generic architecture of any searching algorithm. Some problem is given to you and you have to find out the solution. Now if I consider this searching algorithm is such that it can deal with all types of problems in the world, ideally, that means one can develop a searching algorithm which can deal with all types of problems in the world, and accordingly it will provide a solution. For this time being, this statement seems to be very silly, because as you know, the problem variable, the problem input, will vary from problem to problem. If you are asked to find out the best city in India, which is famous for, say, best city in India, which is famous for example, I may consider some, say, what I can say, depending upon, let me consider different parameters over here. And based on that, you have to select. Suppose one parameter is, say, for example, education. One parameter could have been, say, travel. One parameter could have been, say, scenic beauty. One parameter could have been, say, the city in terms of, say, entertainment, and so on. So if you are to find out the best city, either in the world or in India, which is best in education, which is best in, as far as the travel is concerned, that means there are a lot of places to visit, or scenic beauty you can consider might be there to some extent, they are identical or equivalent, or the best city in the country, which is suitable for entertainment. So as you understand, depending upon the problem statement, the parameter which you want to extract, the corresponding definition of the algorithm is going to modify. It is not just possible for a single algorithm in AI environment to tackle all such problems, because each problem is having its own statement. But since I have also told you in the very first lecture that after the birth of AI in 1956 at Dartmouth College, the AI people, the AI researchers, they are very much optimist. They have claimed that, okay, we can do many things. We can solve all the problems. We can solve all the puzzles which are there through our AI algorithm. So initially, they have started with some algorithms and they have claimed that, okay, using this algorithm, I can solve that particular problem. Using this algorithm, I can solve that particular problem, and so on and so forth. So then the demand has come to regularize those algorithms. Or in other words, the demand has come so that a generic abstraction can be created from each of the algorithms, or each of the searching algorithms. That means if I regard the problem as one variable, which is the input to the searching algorithm, and the solution as another variable, which is the output of the searching algorithm. So I have to model the searching algorithm in such a way that any types of problems or any types of problem input could be fit to the searching algorithm. And the searching algorithm would be able to develop or produce the solution accordingly. And here comes the notion of a state. So what do you mean by state? So it is very much important while we discuss about the searching algorithm in AI domain. So here comes the notion of state. What do you mean by state? State pertaining to any searching algorithm. So state means I can write state as, this is the description of all information about the environment. All information about the environment. Environment means what? The situation under which I am going to solve the problem. Now suppose you have to move from, say, city 1 to city 2 in any particular country. Suppose you would like to visit from, say, Kolkata to Asansol. So this is your problem statement, and there is one constant that you have to take that particular route for which the distance is minimum. So the problem statement is like that. You need to move from Kolkata to Asansol or Kolkata to Durgapur using some vehicle by road. And the objective is to minimize the total distance. So you can have different options available with you. And you have to select the best possible option. Now, this is the problem statement, for example. Now, under this condition, you have to know the road situation, the condition of road, whether there is any agitation, whether there is any blockage or not. What about the set access, if at all, if there is any constant regarding the payment or all. So you have to consider all these things into your mind. The vehicle that you use for this particular purpose, whether you take a bus or you take a car, private car, or you take some other vehicle, or even we can also consider whether you take a train, Apple train. So that depends. But while making this decision, it is not at all important what is the price of sugar at Delhi. So you would like to move from Kolkata to Durgapur, for example, by road. So road means I am considering the railway as well. Now, while taking this decision, okay, one of the objectives is to minimize the total path. Another objective will be to minimize the cost of travel, the total cost that you incur. Another qualitative constant would have been to improve the convenience, whether you're comfortable enough during your visit or not. But in making those decisions, so these are all the information about the environment. So you have to take all the information, you have to collect all the information. But while taking this decision, it is not at all important what is the price of sugar at Delhi. Later on, the state information has been modified to some extent. And it is not at all information about the environment. Rather, people have refined the statement. And it was like all information necessary to take a decision. Necessary to take a decision for us at hand. For the task at hand. So given the problem, you know what is the problem. Now to solve that particular problem, what are the set of necessary information that you need to collect? That is important. If you'd like to move from Kolkata to Delhi, on the other hand, for example, by any means, then apart from the fuel price and all, apart from the total distance, the price, total cost, you need to take a look about the weather condition. Because if you avail the flight, for example, and if the weather condition is not that good, then you may not be able to reach Delhi in time. So then the weather condition is also important to make your decision. So in one word, we can say that state is all about the information about the environment, and rather this particular statement has been refined and it is told to be the all information necessary to take a decision for the task at hand. The other irrelevant decision may not be taken into consideration. Now in regard to that, the states are, in general, can be divided basically into two different segments. One is known as the atomic states, and the second one is known as the propositional state. So accordingly, there could have been two different types of states. One is known as atomic state. I'll be discussing what is meant by atomic state. And another one is propositional state. Now, let us try to understand what is meant by atomic state and what is meant by the propositional state. In case of atomic state, it is said that the states are indivisible. Atomic means, as you understand from the name itself, atomic means states are indivisible. All you know about the state is that this is a particular state, a particular number is associated with the state, but you don't know what is there inside the state. So states are indivisible, that means no internal structure. No internal structure. This is the atomic state. For example, I can say in any particular search problem, there could have been 10 different states, atomic states. So I know that, okay, it is ranging from state 1 to state 2, state 2 to state 3, state 3 to state 4, like this. But we don't know what is there inside the state 1 or inside the state 2. I know, okay, this particular combination will give me state 1. This particular combination of the state variable will give me state 2. And this particular combination of state variable will give me state 3 and so on. And on the other hand, if I consider the propositional state, think as a propositional state. So states are made of state variables, and these state variables will take values. And we are well aware of the scale variables. And we can act on these state variables. So states are made of state variables. And if I consider that there are a finite number of state variables, or rather finite number of states, in that case, these state variables will assume finite values. State variables that take values. For example, I may consider, say, three different state variables. For example, let us consider, give me an example so that you can understand this notion. Suppose, let me call state variables are like say for any particular person and particular agent, let it be say qualified N plus 2 qualified entrance examination and say the third one like maybe say admitted to engineering course. So suppose these are the predefined state variables. Actually, these variables are identified with a interrogatory sign, that whether qualified or not, whether qualified or not, whether admitted or not. So these are the state variables. And accordingly, I can assume the values. Now, since as you understand, initially I'm talking about the propositional logic, a propositional variable. Now, since the question is whether qualified or whether admitted, so the value could be either yes or no. Here, either yes or no. And here, either yes or no. So this is a simple example. So you can have a finite number of values. So I have considered only two values, binary values, because the question is like that. Yes, no question. So I could have, for any particular student, I could have 8 different possibilities. Qualified 10 plus 2, qualified entrance and admitted to engineering course. Qualified 10 plus 2, qualified entrance examination, but not admitted to engineering course. Obviously, there are some states which is not permissible. For example, if somebody qualified 10 plus 2, but did not qualify entrance examination, then he cannot be admitted to an engineering course. So there are some states which are prohibited for this particular state variable problem. So although literally saying there could have been 8 different possibilities because 3 variables are there and each of them can assume 2 values, so yes or no, that means 0 or 1. So you may think that there could have been 8 different possibilities. But however, from your understanding, you must appreciate that there are certain states which are prohibited because this, if you qualify engineering entrance examination, then only you can have a chance to admit in an engineering course. But if this variable is no, then obviously this variable cannot be yes. So anyway, so we can have 8 different possibilities or some. If I just consider the prohibited or not possible states, then obviously the total number of possible states will be reduced to some extent. Now, whenever we are looking this entire problem from this perspective, that whether the state variables I can access and I can understand what is going on, then it is known to be a propositional kind of knowledge representation. And otherwise, I have to identify that, okay, there are eight states. And out of eight states, there are four or five states which are possible. And as you understand, if you did not qualify in 10 plus 2, you don't have any provision to admit to the engineering course, because this last particular variable will depend upon the first two. First two, this 10 plus 2 qualification and entrance qualification. So these two are independent in nature. So you can qualify in 10 plus 2, you may not qualify in entrance examination. You may qualify in both of the examinations. You may not qualify in any of the examination, and the vice versa. That means you might qualify in entrance examination, but you might not qualify in 10 plus 2. So these two, first two state variables, they are independent in nature. But the third one will depend upon specifically on the second one. If the second one is no, then there is no possibility to have the third one yes. So accordingly, you can have different possible or impossible states, prohibited states. So when you look from this particular perspective, when you have the access to each of the variables, then it is known as the propositional variables. And in case the state variables are assumed to be like we cannot access, the internal structure is not known to us, then it is known as like atomic. Now, having considered this one, let us now once again go back to the basic understanding about the searching algorithm. So for searching algorithm, once again, let me identify this as a black box. And let us try to model now, having considered the basic abstraction of any searching algorithm. Now let us try to identify what are the possible inputs and what could have been the possible outputs. So this is the search algorithm. Now, instead of writing input only, previously we have written like input and output, problem and solution, like this. Now let us try to quantify what could have been the possible problem variables, the input variables, which a search algorithm must consider for its proper operation. So I think I am writing in terms of input only, but let me clarify what are the input and what are the outputs. So inputs are, for any search algorithm to operate properly, for example, as I have mentioned, this case of investigation. So if there is any murder, then the policeman has to identify where is the location, what was the location, what was the time of murder, the weapon, and some information about the victim. And apart from that, some algorithms must be there. And based on that, they can identify the person who actually committed the murder. Similarly, for any search algorithm, the inputs are set of states. What are the set of possible states? You must be knowing set of states. Then operators. I'll be mentioning what is meant by operators. Then start state. And then the last one is the goal state. Start state, sorry, it's not start state. Start state and goal state. So set of states. So in your particular problem, and there could have been a number of possible states. So that must be known to the search algorithm, so that it can search over that particular possible states. That means for this investigation problem, the policeman has to know who might be the accused person, depending upon the rivalry which might be there internally or externally with that the person who was murdered. And accordingly, one state will be identified, or more than one state might be identified as a goal state. But the goal is to identify the criminal. And here also, the set of states is the input has to be provided to the system. And what do you mean by the operators? So operators means if you want to move from one state to the other state, by which means you can move. Suppose there is one state, so I'm representing by means of a state space diagram. Suppose one state is there is one. Now I don't know what is there inside. So that's why I have considered it to be like a black box, atomic kind of representation. So knowledge representation here is being done atomically. So that means there is no information about the state inside. So I am observing the state as an abstraction. And suppose from S1, you can move to S2 if some operator, say A1, is applied. From S2, you can move to another state, S3, if some operator A2 is applied. From S2, you can return back to S2 itself if the operator is A3. From S3, you can have a possibility to go back to S1 if the operator is A4, and you can go to another state, that is S4, if the operator is A5. And from S4, you can go to the goal state, S5, if you apply A6. And if you apply A7, suppose S4 will go back to S2. So this might be a possible state space diagram. So this is just a representation, just an illustration to make you understand what is meant by the set of states. So here I have considered, say, 5 different states, S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, and might be out of these 5 states, you understand what is the notion of operator. You start with some initial states. So apart from the set of states, one must be knowing what is the start state, that is S1. So here S1 is the start state. So the game has begun with S1. And then if I apply the different operators, so there are different operators, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, A6, A7, and so on. And might be, these operators might be repeated as well. Although in this particular illustration, I have used like different operators, A1, A2, A3, they're distinct. Might be this A3, I mean, A5 might be called A1, or A6 might be called A4. So it may happen. And so far, we have considered that these operators are deterministic. That means whenever you are in state 1 or S1, and if you apply the operator A1 over it, then you are surely to go to the state S2. But sometimes in some other models, which I'll be discussing some other day, there are some probabilistic transition. That means from the state S1, you can move to either state S2 or to some other state depending upon some probability. Just like this, if I consider state S3 here, I know that if I apply the operator A4, you will go to S1. And if I apply the operator A5, you will move to S4. But these are deterministic, that if you apply A4, you will be surely going to S1. If you apply A5, you will be surely going to S4. So this is the scenario when the environment is deterministic in nature. So the environment with which I am playing the game, this environment is deterministic. All the variables, all the operators, they are deterministic in nature. Now, if there is a certain probability associated with each of these operators, then one might say that from S3 to S1, this could have been done with a probability of 0.5, S3 to S4 with a probability of 0.4, and S3 to S2 with a probability of 0.1. So in that case, it will be a probabilistic kind of transition, and hopefully that will be discussed. Might be in the last lecture today's. I mean, in this particular course, we have the fifth illustration, fifth illustration, and perhaps that might be discussed in the very last day, hopefully. Anyway, so let us now confine ourselves to the present discussion only. Assuming that these operators are deterministic in nature, and we have different states like this. And apart from the set of states, so we need to provide a start state, which is the starting state. So in this particular case, S1 is a starting state, and you must have a goal, because that is the objective of the search algorithm, to find a solution. So solution here is the goal, is to reach at the goal state, and that is known as goal test. This is known as goal test. So there is a domain designer, and the algorithm always asks the domain designer whether you have reached the goal test or not. Suppose you have started with S1. So from S1 to S2, you have reached over there. Suppose I know that S5 is the goal state. This is the goal. This is the goal, and this is the start. So you start from this particular point, and you reached here. S5. After applying the operator A1, we'll move to S2, and then from S2 to S3. So always you move to a new state, you ask the domain designer whether it's a goal state or not. And this is known as goal test. Testing of being at goal state. S2, then the domain designer will say that no, you are not at goal. Then S2 to S3. No, S3 to S4, no, S4 to S5, yes. Then the searching process will be stopped. So whenever you are in the goal state, then the searching process will be stopped. Now in many of the cases, there cannot be a single goal state. There could have been multiple goal state. For example, after you qualify in class 10 plus 2, there could have been different goal, different objective as fixed by you. One objective could have been you can clear the entrance examination, say state level entrance examination engineering. Another goal could have been medical entrance examination. You have to clear this one. Another could have been like central level examination, some IIT joint entrance examination, you have to qualify this one. So there could have been different goal state. So that's why in AI terminology, it is not called like the goal state, rather a goal state. If I just go back to the previous slide, suppose these are the state variables. Here I have considered qualified entrance examination. These are the state variables. Admitted to engineering course. Now you can have a different attributes. That means you can model the entire thing in a different way. And let me identify that one of the goal state is to admit to a reputed engineering college, a state university. That could have been one of your objective or one of the goals. The other goals would have been like you have to admit in any medical institution, medical college. Now, apart from this academics, you can also set the other goals. That you will join a guitar class and you will attend the class. Your another goal could have been like to get the driving license after you qualify for entrance examination. And remember that admission to engineering course or admission to a medical course, so these two different goals cannot be attained simultaneously. Although you can attain or also you can qualify both the joint entrance examination, I mean state level examination and central level examination, or even the medical examination. So if you're talented enough, you can qualify all the examinations. That is possible. But as far as the admission is concerned, you can be admitted to any particular course. Let us say that you have been admitted to any particular engineering college. Now at the same time, you could have also set other goals, like getting a driving license, getting associated with theater, your another objective could have been performing well in guitar. So these are the different goal state. So the bottom line is that for any search problem, there is not a single goal state. There might be more than one goal state, but you have to check whether you have reached any particular goal state or not. And that is known as the goal test. Now these are the inputs for any search algorithm. And let us try to identify what is the output. Output is basically the path, because you know initially there are a set of states, and ultimately wherever you reach, this is nothing but one of the state, because you know you have a set of states, set of possible states rather, and out of which one state is the start state and one state is the goal state, which is known as goal test. So the output, I mean, the goal test is already there. The goal state is already there within the set of states. So you need not create this output. The output is already there. As far as this investigation problem is concerned, initially, you know, these are the people who are associated with that particular victim. And you know that one person is a murderer, for example. Out of 10 people, one is the murderer or one who has committed the crime. So you know that one, the person who is a murderer, you know that the policeman must know that that person is there within the set of the possible murderer. So output cannot be the goal state. Rather, the output is the path. The path that will guide you from the starting state to a state satisfying the goal test. Output here, the path, the way you perform this search operation. The output is basically the path. Path from the start state. Start state to a state, start state to a state, satisfying the goal test. Satisfying the goal test. So to a state, so there could have been more than one goal test. So that will be one path. So this is the output which we are looking for. Now with this understanding about the abstraction of searching process or searching mechanism, now let us go to an example first. Let us consider the example of the 8 puzzle problem. Let me first frame the problem and then we'll try to find out the solution. So you have 8 numbers in a 3x3 square grid. So I have identified the starting location, the starting position, and the goal position. Suppose there is only one goal state in this particular case. So I have told that there could have been more than one goal state, but that may not be necessarily true. There could be one goal state as well. But in general, there could be more than one goal state. So here I have considered only one goal state. So I can safely use the term the goal state. Suppose the numbers are like this, 5, 8, 1, 2, blank, 7, 9, 3, 4. Suppose this is the input state, a starting state, and let the output state could be like this. Say 3, 7, 4, 2, 8, 1, 5, 9. Suppose this is the goal state. So this is the starting state, start state, I should say. And this is the goal state. So you have got this 3x3 grid, and 8 numbers are arranged. 8 numbers and one blank has been arranged. And accordingly, you have to move them so that you reach to this new goal state. So this is a different state from this one. So for this particular problem, first of all, you need to identify what are the states, what could have been the possible states. The inputs you have to identify first. States, a set of states, or rather I should write set of states, as you have done already. So for this particular 8 puzzle problem, let us try to whether this problem can be regarded as a searching problem or not. Forget about the solution. First of all, the formulation of this problem in the paradigm of searching algorithm, a searching process, you have to identify whether this formulation is possible or not. Now, if the formulation is possible, if you can identify, already I have mentioned, for a searching algorithm, what could have been the possible input variables and what could have been the possible output variables. Those set of states, the operators, the starting state and the goal state. So these are the possible inputs, and the output is nothing but the path from the start state to the goal state. Now for this particular problem, 8 puzzle problem, where you need to find out this final goal state from this particular starting state. Now if you can accomplish this one using the notion of this searching algorithm, as you mentioned, then I can regard, okay, now this is a searching problem. And then you can put your effort to solve the problem. So let us try to identify whether we can find out those variables or not. So first of all is the set of states. So in order to regard this particular problem as a searching problem, you have to identify the set of states. Is it possible to identify the set of states? Yes. So there are 9 numbers. So if I consider blank as a number, so 8, 5, 8, 1, 2, blank, 7, 9, 3, 4. This is the start state, and the goal state is blank, 3, 7, 4, 2, 8, 1, 5, 9. So this set of states So there could have been altogether 9 factorial possibilities. 9 factorial. If I consider this blank as a number, so I can arrange them in 9 factorial fashion. So these are the set of states, which is nothing but the location of the tiles, location of the numbers. Depending upon the location of the numbers, you can have the different states. And out of that, one state is the start state and the one state is the goal state. Location of numbers. And start state and goal state has already been mentioned. And the operators. Operators, now you have to identify. What are the possible operators which you can apply over here? The operator is that you have a blank in the middle. Now to shuffle the numbers, so either you need to move the blank either upwards or downwards or left or right. So these are the possible operations in one particular step. In one particular step, so these are the possible operations. Either you move this blank left, or you move the blank right, or you move the blank up, or you move the blank down. So in one step, so these are the possible operators. So let me write it down, the operators. Move the blank left or right or up or down. Left, right. So these are the possible operators. So there are altogether 4 operators. Move the blank left, move the blank right, move the blank up, or move the blank down. However, under every possible condition, you cannot apply all the operators. For example, if the blank is at this particular position under a certain point, then you cannot further move the blank up, or you cannot move the blank left, because the only 2 options are available to you: to move the blank either right or to move the blank either down. But these are the all possible operators. For example, as I've told you, if I just consider this particular example, that if you did not qualify an entrance examination, then you don't have any chance to get admitted to the engineering course. So no matter whatever be the operator, but you cannot be able to get admitted in an engineering course if you did not qualify the entrance examination. However, if I consider the entire environment, so this could have been the possible different operators. And goal test, you understand, this is the goal test, the goal state. And I may consider, so obviously sometimes some path cost is also associated with the searching process, but right now I am not going to discuss the path cost. I think it will be discussed later on, so that you can appreciate this one. So now I identify that the movement of the blank, to the left or right or up or down, creates the same discomfort or create the same kind of actions from ourselves. So either you move the blank up, or you move the blank down, or you move the blank left, or you move the blank right, the corresponding action being taken from outside being the same. So no additional action has to be done to move the blank left as compared to that to move the blank right, and so on. So how to solve this problem? If I just consider, so initially the blank is here. So let me show over here what you have started with. So I don't know what should be the possible solution. I know the solution, but I don't know what should be the possible path initially. So I have to do some random operation like this. So I've started with 581, 27, 934. So this is my starting state. And from the starting state, I could apply four different operators because the blank is in middle. So since the blank is in middle, so I can always apply four different operators. Nobody stops me. Accordingly, four different new states will be generated from this particular starting state. So if I use the operator up, if I move the operator down, if I move the operator left, and if I move the operator right, I would be having different states. If you move it up, then it will look like let me draw the grid first. If you move it up, it will be 5, blank 1, 2, 8, 7, 9, 3, 4. If I move it down, then it will be 581, 237, 9 blank 4. If I move the operator left, I mean this blank left, use the by using the operator left, if I move the blank, so left, that means 581, blank 27, 934. And we do have the last possible state from this one, from the starting state. Just by moving the operator right. So in that case, it will be like 581, 27 blank, 934. So these are the four different states which I have got. In fact, I have exploited all the possible states. So from this, only four possible states is possible. So I have got all this 1, 2, 3, 4. And then the next question is that what are the possible operators that can be applied over here? So as you understand, either you can blank, you have a blank over here, either you can move the blank left or you can move the blank right or you can move the blank down. So here you can apply three different operators because the fourth operator moving the blank up is not possible because this is in the topmost row. However, so there is a notion. So I think first let me identify the possible different operators. So either you move it like left, or you move it like right, or you move it like down. Here, you can have similarly either left or right or up. Now you cannot go down because this is the last row. Now here, you can move up, you can move down, or you can move the blank to the right, but you cannot move the blank to the left because this is the leftmost column. And here, you can move this blank up, or you can move the blank down, or you can move the blank left. So accordingly, this search space is expanded and you can get a new solution, I mean new set. However, from this particular state, already this is obtained from this particular state by applying the operator U. Now, if you apply the operator D, once again, you will go back to the original state or starting state. Here also, by applying D from the starting state, you have got this one, this particular state. Now, once again, if you apply the operator U, you will go back to this state. The same is true for this one. By applying L, you have come over here. Now, if you once again apply R, you will be going back to the starting state. And the same is true for the last one as well. So, if you apply D here, so the same states, same starting state will be repeated. And as a matter of fact, there is a possibility that the overall complexity of the system is getting enhanced. Now, if you do not have any check policy to rectify whether the same state has been generated or not, then the entire structure which is developed in this manner is known as a search tree. So this entire thing is known as search space. This is known as search space in general because we are exploiting the overall set of states. Now, if you do not have any criteria to check whether the same state has been repeated or not, then you have a duplicacy, and this is known as a search tree kind of thing. Now, if you apply this one, there is D again, U again, R again, and L again, and you'll be developing something in which the repetition of nodes are there, then it is known as search tree. With duplicacy. However, if this duplicacy is removed, that means one state is exploited in the search space only once, then it is known as a search graph. So in case of search graph, the duplicacy is removed. However, in search tree, you are considering all such duplicacy to be there. And accordingly, you have to identify or you have to explore all the possible states. And every time you explore, then you have to ask the domain designer whether you have reached the goal state or not. If the answer is yes, so in this particular case, you have only one goal state to reach at that particular combination. Now, if you have already arrived, then your search process will be completed and the output is nothing but the path from the starting state to the goal state. Now, sometimes you can also reach to the same path by different, or you can also reach to the same goal state by different paths. In which case, sometimes you may require to have the shortest path. Say either from this point, the path length might be, say, in some case, the path length might be, say, 10, and in some other case, the path length might be, say, 8 or 7. So you can reach to the goal state by applying a few operators on the starting state in one case, or by applying more operators in other case. So accordingly, there could have been different implications, and I'll be discussing these implications later on. Now, this type of problem, so you must understand that here, the total possible, as I have started with, the total possible combination, I mean, the total possible states, here is 9 factorial, because we have 9 numbers in this grid formation, 3x3 grid. We have 9 numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, only 6 is not there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, and blank. Even also, you can insert, instead of considering the blank, you can also insert 6 over there. And it makes no difference. But anyway, so To make sense, I have inserted blank so that you can have a notion that I can move the blank up, I can move the blank down, and right and left, and so on. Now, since the number of possible states is 9 factorial, and which is finite, which is large, I must appreciate, the number is very large, pretty large, but this is finite. And now, if you go by this process, one after another, by exploiting the nodes, exploiting those states one after another, then obviously there is a time when you reach to the goal state. There is a possibility that you might reach to a goal state. Because the goal state is there. Out of this 9 factorial, suppose this is the number, out of 9 factorial, these are the two states. I think all of you have played Sudoku. This is a kind of example which is very much, which is having very high resemblance with Sudoku. Almost the same, right? Now what happens? Out of 9 factorial possibility, you have to identify the final goal here. So the final goal is the only one state which is having the organization of numbers in this particular fashion. But the way you go on searching, there is no such guidance on the way. You can take any arbitrary path to solve it. Obviously, you should start by considering a pattern. So you have a starting state. So you first you operate or use all the operators U, D, L, and R, and got some new states. And once again, you go on exploiting all these states to reach a solution. Now, since we do not have any kind of prior information to move, that means in which way should I move, in which way should I change the blank, either up or down or left or right, and then after one state, what should be the next step? So you don't have any option. You are doing it like a randomly. So therefore, this type of searching where you don't have any prior information regarding how to reach to the goal, you go on searching, and if it is found, then you are happy. So this type of searching phenomenon where you are not at all informed about how to proceed, this is known as uninformed search. Obviously, you must follow a particular pattern depending on the algorithm. So this is uninformed search. So depending upon the algorithm, you should follow a rule. But the algorithm is independent of the problem under consideration. So I'll be discussing the algorithms one after another. Then you'll find that the algorithm is itself, it has nothing to do with the problem under consideration. Irrespective of the problem, irrespective of the problem statement, if the algorithm has its own way of action, then it has to be followed blindly to all the problems. So for this uninformed type of searching, we have to identify some of the search strategies. Now let us take a look at the search strategy. What are the search strategy? And depending on the search strategy, we will be developing or we will be discussing about the different types of search algorithms. So what do you mean by search strategy? So search strategy is defined by, so this is defined by picking the order of node expansion. This state can be identified as node. If I just consider the individual value, that means in under atomic consideration, this is acting as a state. Suppose this is state 1, this is state 2, state 3, state 4, state 5, and so on. But if I do not consider the atomic consideration, rather, if I know the individual position of each of the numbers inside a state, then it is not known like a node. And you know how to move in this particular node or how to reach at that particular node from a given starting node. So as I was mentioning, this search strategy is defined by picking the order of node expansion. How to expand the node? Picking the order of node expansion. And depending upon this order of node expansion, we could have different search strategies available in the literature. And obviously, since there are more than one search strategy, the next question is that whether, or rather, how to compare the performances of those different search strategies. So these strategies are evaluated by means of different parameters. So the evaluation is done whether the search strategy one is better than two or two is better than three or not. So this evaluation is done on the basis of several parameters. What are those parameters? The first one is completeness. What do you mean by completeness? It means that, does it always find a solution? Using the search strategy, is it sure that you'll be getting a solution? Suppose solution is there. Does it always find a solution? So this is the first question against any search strategy, the completeness. Okay, we are exploring the nodes one after another by certain strategy, by certain rule. Now, whether this node expansion will ultimately result in the final goal or goal state. Is it so? I'm assuming that the goal state exists as obvious for this particular case. I know this is the goal state. So obviously there is a possibility if you move this blank up, or if you move the blank down or right or left, and so other numbers, if you arrange properly, then obviously there's a possibility that you can come over here. But the thing is that for any search problem, the first evaluation criteria is that whether it is complete or not. So the property is completeness. Does it always find a solution? If it exists, then is it guaranteed to find a solution, to have a solution from a search problem? Then the second property is about the time complexity. Obviously, you understand what is meant by time complexity. So time complexity is nothing but the number of nodes generated. Number of nodes generated. So to find the solution, to find the ultimate solution, how many number of nodes you need to generate so that ultimately you reach the solution. That is all about the time complexity. Now, if you have to generate more number of nodes, then obviously your time complexity is large. And that is obviously, it's not a good searching strategy. Then comes the space complexity. So what do you mean by space complexity? So space complexity is defined by the maximum number of nodes in the memory. Because you need to store the nodes accordingly. Because ultimately, what is the output? Output is not the goal state. Because you know the goal state. What is the goal state? That is already defined as an input to the problem. The output is a path. How are you reaching to that particular goal? So the algorithm must be able to keep a track of the number of nodes being exploited. And accordingly, it must store the information about the nodes which are exploited in a memory. So in connection to that, the space complexity is defined as the maximum number of nodes in the memory, which you need to keep so that it is ensured that whenever the goal is reached, the algorithm is capable enough to provide the current path through which the solution is obtained. The redundant part, the unnecessary part, is not at all taken into consideration. So during the course of action, if the algorithm finds that, okay, I should not keep in track all these different nodes. If I keep track of these nodes or this set of nodes, then it is possible for me to identify the path. So that part is redundant. That part is not at all necessary. So then that path, that set of nodes can be thrown away. But the number of nodes which are essential to be kept in the memory is known as the space complexity. Then the fourth one is the optimality. And optimality has something to do with the completeness. What is meant by optimality? So whenever the search algorithm is complete in nature, that means it can always provides you a solution. As I already mentioned that you can reach to the goal state by different means, either from this state to that state, then by using 10 operators, or by using 7 operators, or by using 5 operators. So within a search space, so there is a possibility. If I just consider the search tree, not the search graph, the search tree where there is a repeated kind of thing. So there is a possibility that you may reach to the goal many a times. Even that is true for the search graph. You may reach to the goal many a times. But whenever you are moving from the search state to the start state to the goal state, the corresponding path cost may not be the same. If you'd like to move from Kolkata to Delhi, you can take different routes. Either you avail bus, or you avail train, or you avail your personal car, or you can avail flight. You can also avail bicycle, you can also avail motorcycle. And you can also go by foot. So there are different options available to you. So you can start from Kolkata and you can reach to Delhi. But all the solutions are not optimal. Now here, as far as the searching strategy is concerned, optimality means finding a solution which will give you the least cost. So whenever we compute the cost, so there sometimes we can also consider the different attributes into our mind. Now, if your only priority is about the money, then you must spend as minimum as possible while selecting the vehicle. So obviously, you should not go for a flight if money is the criteria. If you understand money as cost, sometimes you may think that the cost means time. That means I would like to minimize the cost. That means I would like to minimize the time. For this case, you must have a flight because you know if you have a flight, you can reach to Delhi within 2.5 hours. On the other hand, if you have a train, so it will take almost say 20 hours or so. If you take bus, even more. Now, if your criteria is to optimally select between the train and the flight, that means both the money as well as the time is important, equally important to you, then accordingly you have to select some other means. But here in the something like that, we are considering optimality, the least cost. So obviously I'll be mentioning what is the cost. So optimality means that does it always find the least cost solution. Ultimately, sometimes the systematicity is also defined. And which is identified like whether this state is visited at most once or not. So does it visit? Each state at most once. This is practically important for search tree, because since in case of search tree there could have been a multiplicity or duplicacy in the nodes, and if you go on visiting one node many a times, then obviously it will not be at all efficient as far as the algorithm is concerned. So these are the different parameters on the basis of which the evaluation is being done for different search strategy. And they are measured, these time and space complexities, they are measured in terms of certain parameters. So the time and space complexity So this is measured in terms of, so how to measure this one, because these are ultimately numbers, so there should have been some variable. What are the variables? So they are measured in terms of maximum branching factor of the source tree. Maximum branching factor of the source tree. Which is identified by the parameter B. Then the depth of the least cost solution which is identified by the parameter D in literature, and the third one is the maximum depth of the state space. Which is normally identified by M. Now let us try to identify, or let us try to understand what is meant by each of these factors. What is meant by B, what is meant by D, and what is meant by M. So B stands for the maximum branching factor of the source tree. For example, if we start with a state, say S, any state S, so this is known to be the parent state, and from this parent state we can have a number of child state, 1, 2, 3, 4, depending upon the operators that you select. So the maximum branch factor, so number of those children produced by this particular search or this particular state, is known as the maximum branching factor. So this is B. Now, if I consider this 8 puzzle problem, you understand that. So here I can write, for example, 8 puzzle problem. for this 8 puzzle problem, B was equal to 4. So maximum branching factor of the search tree. So from a particular state, how many operators you can apply so that to reach to different states from one state. So this is known as a maximum branching factor. Then let me go to the third one first, the maximum depth of the state space. So while doing that, the same operation, so what is done after you start from the search, the starting state S, then you have got a new state, say S, S1, for example, then might be there could have been some possible children. And then each of the children might be also explored in this way. And ultimately, the state space is created in that fashion. Then this particular state is exploited, and this particular state is exploited, and so on and so forth. Ultimately, the state space is exhausted. So the maximum depth of the state space is known as M. So what is that? So this is known to be the depth. So you start from this state S. So this is at depth 0. The initial state, starting state, apparent node. Then from this particular state, we have a first depth in which you have, say, maximum B number of such states. So B is the maximum number, might be less than B. Then you have from each of these states will be once again exploited. So in this way, this is state depth 0, this is depth 1, depth 2, depth 3, and so on. So the maximum depth of the search state space is known as M. If you go on exploring one after another, and ultimately you come to an end where it cannot be further exploited. So this is known as the maximum depth of the state space. And let us come back to this second variable, the D. What is D? D is the depth of the least cost solution. I know that while exploring the nodes in this way, suppose my goal state is present over here. Suppose the maximum depth of the state space might be, let's say, 20 or 30. So I'm going exploring like this way, and ultimately the depth of the state space is increasing. But hopefully the result, the best solution, least cost solution, is available over here. Then accordingly, what is the depth corresponding to this least cost solution? So this is D. So this depth of the least cost solution might not be known to the algorithm itself, but you as a designer, you might understand what should be the depth of the least cost solution. But the algorithm, the searching algorithm, is completely unaware of this particular value. But based on this particular value, you can make a comparative study how far your searching algorithm is working well, or how good is the algorithm. So these are the certain criteria on the basis of which you can consider the different searching algorithms. And with this introductory beginning about the searching phenomena and the different attributes associated with that, let me conclude this part of the lecture. And in the next part of this particular lecture, I'll be talking about the different types of searching algorithms which are existing in the literature over the years.